Jesus, work in the rain, spreading the gospel, we'll never complain. Though the days may grow long, we'll strive harder to be all the cowboys for Jesus should be. On the wide open prairie, through the day and the night, we'll carry the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Like the clear stars in heaven, or the desert so bright, we'll have a roundup with the gospel of light.
We're going to start there we go. We got to get this started. We have a lot to watch. How many of you have got Facebook and have watched on Facebook during the time? I tell you what, it's a blessing. You'd be amazed at how many people watch and view that throughout the week. We're blessed to have all of you on Facebook, and those that'll get on be there for YouTube as well. It's a ministry. We're not on TV locally in Enid anymore since they shut down the TV station, but we're working. I have some things in mind to pick some of those things back up in time, but y'all just continue to pray and believe God for the right things and the right opportunities and everything to come together. Good. They watch it on the YouTube. They pull it up on their TV and or Facebook on their TV. You know, that's a neat thing. One of the things this COVID deal has probably helped, I believe, is that people that weren't very techie or connected have gotten that away. And so in that sense, I think it's good. So I'm thankful for it. So let me ask you a question. Are you expecting? Yeah. Well, that's good. That's what we want to be. Let's join together in prayer and prepare for Greg to come minister to us. Father, we just come before you tonight, and Lord, we just thank and praise you that this is the day that you've made. We'll rejoice and be glad in it. That, Lord God, we can come before your presence with singing, and we can enter your courts with praise. And Lord, we just thank you for this night, that, Lord, these that are here, that have given their time, those that are watching across the nation and even around the world, that, Lord God, we just invite each and every one into the presence of God through this service. And Father God, I pray and I ask you to minister through every part and aspect of this service. We give you glory and honor and praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, Greg McDougal is here. How many of you have been here whenever he's been here before? It's been a couple of years, maybe three even, but since he hadn't been here since I've been here. But it was one that when I was looking back through the people that we hadn't had yet, going back through some of the old videos, I said, man, we need to try to get that guy back. And so it's good to have him here. We're going to be blessed by him. So I'm going to turn it over to Greg. You give him a round of applause.
Put your hand in the hand of the man, still the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man, calms the sea. Take a look at yourself, you can't look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Every time I look into the holy book, I want to tremble. When I think about the part where the carpenter cleared the temple, the buyers and the sellers are no different fellers than what I can sometimes be. It causes me shame to know I'm not the man that I can be sometimes. Put your hand in the hand of the man, still the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man, calms the sea. Take a look at yourself, you can't look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. I'm gonna do several half songs here. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, Hallelujah, by and by I'll fly away.
Amen.
I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Let's do I'll Fly Away again.
I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Amen. Hi, y'all. My name's Greg. I live in Tennessee, about 25 miles outside of Nashville. I was telling them up there when we had prayer that all the times I've been here before, I believe, I had a young'un or two with me. First couple of times I was here, I had four little ones and a wife who was busy. And so just driving through Enid coming here was nostalgic to me in ways that if I think about it too much, I'll be sobbing like a little girl down here. Looking around the building, there was one time we were upstairs and we had our CD duplicating machines up there, and my wife and daughters and two boys were up there. They were making CDs as fast as they could to make sure we had some CDs to give to y'all. And I've got them on a table out there. We don't charge a thing for our CDs. It's just the way God led us to do it. We want you to have one as our gift. It is new stuff from the last time we were here. We handed the same stuff out for years and years, and finally we got some new stuff. And so I hope you'll be blessed by it. That there is the container that I keep the CDs in. If you're led to sow into that part of our ministry, that's up to you. But please do not leave here without one as our gift to your life, okay? I have a song that I wrote that I have to sing all the time, because I didn't think that I knew any praise and worship songs one morning. And when I needed to worship, when God told me to be still and know that He is God, because I was up against the wall with one of my kids, I suddenly needed a praise and worship song so bad I couldn't see straight. And He's been teaching me that this worship time, the reason why we sing praise and worship in whatever form, is because of our gratitude. As we remember the goodness of God, we remember just one little thing, like me remembering being here with my kids. God did that. And He is so good to us. And I don't know about y'all, but I've heard story after story of people who have told how He has provided through this pandemic thing. Amen? For that alone, we can be so thankful. And the Bible says that He inhabits the praises of His people. So let's just give Him praise. When I needed a praise and worship song and I didn't think I knew any, He gave me one. And I'm thankful. I just started singing, Father, I praise You. Father, I worship You. Thank You for Jesus saving my soul. That's pretty simple, isn't it? He's got to keep it simple for some of us. Father, I praise You. Father, I worship You. What are you thankful for Him tonight? Thank You for Jesus.
saving my soul. 'Cause I'm the prodigal son. You ran out and covered my shame. I'm the leper you healed. I've come back to lift up your name. Just like Peter said, Lord, where else could I go? You're the Son of God, the Christ. This one thing I know, that I know, that I know, that I know. Can I get an amen? Father, I praise you. Father, I worship you. Father, I worship you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for Jesus and saving my soul and saving my soul. That was practice. Ready? Here we go. Father, I praise you. Father, I praise you. Sing it to him. Father, I worship you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for Jesus and saving my soul and saving my soul. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving my soul. And I'm going to finish this song with this. 'Cause I can't even walk without you holding my hands. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, that's where I learned to stand. I can't even walk without you holding my hands. Amen. There's the truth right there. Down on my knees, where I'm learning to stand. I can't even walk without you holding my hands. And all God's people said, amen. God is my witness. I got time to do three songs here, and here comes my third one. But it's not mine. All this belongs to him. The time, the effort, the strength. Amen. The song. So, Lord, which one would you have me do? And I believe that he's led me to this one here. This is a country song that was on mainstream radio. Everybody and their brother was playing and singing this song back then. And I'm going to age myself. Telling myself about, I just turned 52 this year. I remember as a kid hearing this song everywhere. And it's no small thing. Why me, Lord, what have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Why me, Lord, what did I ever do was worth loving you and the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it so. Help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands.
Boy, that's taking the score and reviewing the math, isn't it? Amen? That stirs up gratitude in our hearts. Boy, that brings about worship, doesn't it? Remembering that without Him. Try me, Lord. If you think there's a way I could try to repay all I've taken from you, maybe, Lord, I could show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it so. Help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I needed you so, help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Amen.
David.
Got you. Okay. Man, he's good. We got to have him back later. What do y'all think? Thank you, Greg. Awesome. And I'm going to show my age. That's one of my favorite songs when I was a little kid. So, if you've got any little Wranglers, go ahead and go right up there and be dismissed. I don't think I see any. Dayla, you and Chris can go on up there for old time's sake if you want to. We've got men's Bible study on Tuesday mornings at 7. They meet right up here at 7 in the morning. Mike does a great job of ministering to everyone at that deal. I want to thank Dakota and his family for letting us use this sale barn. There's been so many lives saved in the 13 to 15 years, however many years we've been here, just because they come into a sale barn where they might not, you know, they might not ever go into a traditional type church, and they felt welcome here, and the Lord went, you know, come into their hearts. Just really been really a blessing to see that, and we just appreciate that Dakota lets us continue doing that. He also has a cafe open. I think he opens at 5 o'clock before church on Tuesdays. I almost said Thursday, but anyway, Tuesdays. We have any birthdays or anniversaries today? Got one right there. 81. Well, you're a spring chicken. Happy birthday. Oh, yeah? Well, Harvey, you didn't tell me. You knew better, didn't you? Happy birthday, Jackie and Bill. Thank you. Happy birthday. We got singers. Oh, yep. Well, how about that? Congratulations. She getting you lined out, too, isn't she? So, all right. We've got singers coming up. Of course, we've got Greg tonight. We've got the Hunt family coming on the 30th next week. And then got Gizmo McCracken. He's a rodeo clown, an NFR, and he'll be here. He's going to be here on the 7th. And then Jenny Engel will be here on the 14th. And I'll be booking some others throughout the month. We've got some booked through the year that travel through here. With this virus thing, I just haven't booked a whole year in advance because there's been a lot of people, you know, couldn't come and things. Changed our way of life. We've got buckets around here. If y'all feel in your heart that you want to give to help us out, we'd appreciate it. But only if you feel like the Lord's telling you to. Nobody wants to force you to do anything like that. I'm sure a few people will be asking about my mother-in-law. Well, my wife had an injury too. My mother-in-law had her surgery today at Integris. We'd prayed from the beginning, Kelly, and the way he's taught us to pray here at this church, to pray specific, is just, I've seen it work time and time again. So we were praying. The first report was it could be cut out and everything would be fine. Well, boy, then the doctors said, you know, this and that and the other. Well, make a long story short, it was just exactly what we had prayed for at first. They cut it out. She got out. Everything looks like it's going to be fine. They're not going to have to do chemo, radiation. Just God just took care of that deal. Just really awesome. And then my wife doesn't probably know this yet. I run into her ortho in the dressing room at St. Mary's, and he said, I need to call your wife. I said, well, she's busy today. So she's only going to have physical therapy on her knee injury, so I'm praising God for that. His word, she's going to have surgery. And I'll probably be selling that horse. But anyway, Kelly, you want to come up and do our prayer request? And thank you.
That's good news. That's what we want to hear about that knee and talk to you about that horse. But anyway, we also had another great praise request, our praise report. Donna Prochaska, we'd been praying for her. She was able to, usually they sit right up over here by Gary, but hadn't been here for quite a while. But she's been waiting on that heart valve surgery. She was in Monday, got that done. Everything went good. And then today got to come home. They put a temporary pacemaker in just to make sure we're going to put a permanent one in if need be, but they don't need to. And that's what we were believing God for, so she's doing good, had a good report. So we're very thankful about those. Also, just want to make mention of, we had a few prayer requests. Eric Waldy had surgery, is having surgery on teeth and needs pain to cease. So, boy, that can be a challenge, so we want to pray for that. Want to lift up Forgotten Ministries is written down here. Just continue to lift that ministry up, ministering to homeless and just a lot of the areas of that the churches don't minister. And so they're we want to lift them up. Rex Suit had knee surgery and he's doing good. So we want to continue to lift him up though on the recovery. Everybody knows that somebody's had knee replacement or major knee surgery. That's a process. So we want to continue to lift him up. Rick Adair, liver, we continue to pray for his condition, battling liver cancer. Richard Wabstack has a toe surgery, lift him up, and then Mike Johnson's health. So those were some that were mentioned there. Was there any that I missed? Who? Sharon Kane, continue to pray for her. What's the latest? Do you? Right. Okay. And she had a hip or ribs, they were working on several things, but continued to lift her up. So, all right. Well, let's lift these needs up. Let's go before the Lord. You know, we also want to pray over the offering, and we want to pray over the blessing of this building and the business here. So let's go before the Lord. Father, we just come before you and. Lord, we just lift up these needs to you. We thank you, Lord, that as we pray over each one and every one of these, that, Lord, we can praise and thank you for the ones who have already been answered, but those others that are being lifted up are going through ongoing challenges and ongoing therapy and ongoing treatments, that, Lord God, you continue to strengthen their bodies, continue to minister to them that are receiving those treatments and receiving that care. And Lord, we just ask for the end result of health and restoration. Lord, we just pray and lift those up. We continue to pray over this nation. That was one that was written down here that we didn't have. And Father, we just continue to pray over this nation that the unrest would and the division and the confusion and all the things that are pulling us apart, Lord, that you would step into the middle of that. And that, Lord God, we'd have the wise leaders rise up to squelch those that are being the instigators of the division and the strife, that, Lord God, we could bring this nation together as unified under God. And, Father God, we stand for this nation to remain one nation under God. And we give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, we just pray over those that give, that sow into this offering. And Lord God, we thank and praise you. That's the way we demonstrate our trust in you. And then, Lord God, we thank you that whenever we give that money, we're not just plucking it in the bucket, but Lord God, we're sowing seed into the kingdom of God. And when we do that, Lord God, we have your promise of provision. And Lord, we thank and praise you that we can stand in agreement and pray that blessing over everyone that sows in this ministry, and we thank you for it. And Lord God, we just continue to lift up Enid Livestock Market, Dakota and Clarissa and their family, and all those that work here, that Lord God, you continue to increase this business. You continue to prosper them because they've dedicated their business to the ministry and for the praise of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we just ask that you continue to bless them. Bring in the cattle from the north, south, east, and west. Bring buyers that can take care of that market. We give you praise for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, it's good to have you tonight. Glad you're here. And I'm just excited about an opportunity to share the Word. I share the Word every morning at 6:30 on High Call Ministries Facebook page. Some of you tune in there, and I do a little 20-30 minute ministry there, and of course on Sunday morning up at Carrier, but man, I tell you what, there's nothing quite like being here. I just always love this setup and this venue. But I got a funny for you. There were two boys at a wedding, and one of them leaned over to the other and asked, "How many wives can a man have?" Friend said, "Well, 16, of course. 4 better, 4 worse, 4 richer, and 4 poorer." Boy, I don't know. I certainly wouldn't want 16 at one time. I think one is all I can handle. So anyway, I've been trying for 34 years to get her straightened out, and you know how that goes. So anyway, no, it's been good. We're blessed. She's out here. I thought you were in there taking care of the kids. I better be careful. Luke chapter 5, let's go there. I got a message tonight, and this is part 2 of following Jesus' command. We talked about this last week, and I just challenged you to follow the command of Jesus. Now, we know what his number one command is, and that's to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And we know that if we'll walk in that we fulfill the Ten Commandments, we fulfill all the law, we'll walk in a blessed life if we can just learn how to do that. But within the just everyday life and within looking at the Scripture and within our relationship, He's giving us words, He's giving us direction, He's giving us commands. You know, we know a few commands that He's given us. He said, forgive. Oh man, come on, preacher, you could go all night without saying forgive. No, Jesus didn't just suggest that, but He commands us to forgive. He commands us to love. He commands us to trust Him. There's all kinds of things in the Scripture. But we used the illustration of Luke chapter 5, and we were talking about how Jesus in verse 1 was standing on the lake of Gennesaret, which is also the Sea of Galilee. And He says that the people were pressing in. They were crowding around Him to hear, to listen to the Word of God. And I challenged you to be hungry for the Word of God, to desire the Word of God. You know, there is all kinds of craziness going on in this world. I can watch the news and I'm just plumb mad. My wife said, "Quit watching that stuff." I can look at some of the things going on in this world and just be agitated, get fired up. Or I can stay with the Word of God and stay even and stay steady and know that the one thing that it will never change is the Word of God, and I can stand firm in the Word. But I got to be willing to hear, willing to listen. You know, I'll come home a lot of times on times like this where I've studied all day and I've preached a sermon, and I go home and I listen to more Word for me. You know, if there's one thing I've learned over 30 years of ministry is that I got to keep me full, because I'm giving out all the time, and that's why so many ministers don't last. I think I heard a statistic that there's only 5% of ministers that start in their 20s that hit the 30-year mark. That's an amazing stat. That there's only a few that are able to maintain being in ministry. And I can tell you that it's difficult whenever you're pouring out and all the time, you got to keep you full. Well, listen, you're different in the sense that you're not preaching maybe every day, all day, or in these different situations. But you have a constant pull on you. We have a constant pull. Many of you have to work or live with or around people that are just negative. Hopefully they're not sitting right there beside you. But, you know, sometimes we have negative pull in our life, right? We turn on the TV. That's a negative drain. I've got this one place, one quarter that I lease doesn't have a real good fence around it. And so I run an electric fence, a hot wire, on the inside, and it's not close to the power source. I have to use solar chargers. And it's one half of a half section, but it's 160 acres, so there's half a mile on three sides that aren't good fence. And so I have to run this hot wire. Well, there is this time of year, the Johnson grass grows up and along the fence, and the weeds grow up and along the fence. And I got the best, I mean, they're not cheap. I got really good fence chargers on this place. But yesterday, I was up there and I was checking the cattle, and that fence wasn't very hot. Well, we'd had a rain, and that Johnson grass is green, and that thing will snap through there pretty good till it starts getting wet. And what's it doing? It's pulling on that charger. Now, that battery, that's got a solar panel that charges that battery on a constant basis. But we'd had a couple of cloudy days. What was happening? There's less juice going in the battery. Not quite as much going in there. And then there's more pull because it's wet. And it's got all this growing around it. And pretty soon, I'm wondering, okay, God, I was thinking about switching. I've got one charger that does two halves of that, two half miles, so a mile. And I've got one that just does one side, that there's almost no fence there. So I want that one to be really hot. This other one, it kind of got some fence there, and it looks scary. And as long as they don't get to, you know, they just, you know how this is, if you have cattle. But here's the thing: I'm walking, I'm driving out the gate. I had gone through this fence, most all of this fence, and I could see that the wire wasn't shorted out, but it was just barely sparking. I'm putting my screwdriver and touching the post, and I'm just barely tick. Just barely I was getting enough. I wasn't grabbing hold of it, but not enough that it was enough that it was going to keep those cows from leaning on that fence. Well, you know, I'm driving out, and I was running out of time, and I thought, you know what? I'm just going to trust they'll just stay in. They've been good cows, hadn't got out. It'll be all right. I'll mess with it later. And I'm driving out the gate, and I was on my gator, and I went over by this one electric fence gate, and I get ready to head out of there, and I could see the fence up the. Then I didn't go down this one half mile. Now the Lord spoke to me, I had a thought. You know, it wasn't like an audible voice. It wasn't like, "Oh, thou Kelly." You know, it wasn't like that. It was just I had the thought drive up that fence. And I almost didn't listen. In fact, I drove through the gate, getting out to get shut it. And I thought, "Oh, no, I'm not going to do that. I know better than that." And so I back up and I drive down this. And sure enough, there was not only all that Johnson grass on there, but the deer probably had, or cows, something had knocked one insulator off one of those posts, and sure enough, that fence is up against a dead short on that electric fence post. Now listen, just the fact, this shows you how good my charger was, that I was getting any hot on that mile worth of grown-over fence. All that pull and all that draw, but that one dead short was more than it could handle. Now this one had a gauge on it, and that gauge will usually run up there in the green quite a way. Well, it was pulled way down, so I knew it was pretty good short. But I thought, I went up there, fixed that, got back down there, and what I have, it was up in the green. It was all taken care of because I listened to God's voice, God's direction, God's impression on me, the Holy Spirit reminding me, showing me where the problem was. I had driven three quarters, I was kind of like, well, God, I could have come here first. Saved me a lot of time. No, I didn't say that, really. But see, I had to take it and prevent that drain and that draw. Didn't matter how hot that fence was. Didn't even matter how full that battery was. When that dead short was on there, it wasn't going to be at full capacity. See, when we go to the Word of God on a daily basis, we got to feed on the Word and hear the Word and listen and obey in order to receive. And so this is what the people developed a hunger in this Luke chapter 5, and they're pressing in to hear the Word. Now, we go on down, and you remember, I don't want to go all through this, I taught it last week, but you know, Jesus asked Peter, he said, "Let me get in your boat." He found his boat and he said, push me out just a little ways so that I got a little buffer between me and the people so that I can use the amplification of the water. He didn't say all that, but that's all happening, right? He's using Peter's boat. Now, Peter had to make a choice to be used. He had to make a choice to be willing to hear and obey the command of Jesus. Now, it got better, though, because after Jesus ministered, then he wanted to bless Simon. He wanted to bless Peter, and he gave him the opportunity, and he told him in verse 4, he says, when he finished speaking, he said to him, put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. Now, you'll remember last week I gave you three things that he was saying right there. He, first of all, he commanded him to launch out into the deep. And you know what? Peter had a choice. He could have argued with Jesus. In fact, he made a statement, kind of, you know, hey Jesus, I am a professional fisherman, and I know, you know, kind of like I could have said, well, you know, the insulators are never off this side of the fence. It's all due to that. No, he gave me an opportunity, and I took it. Well, here Peter takes it. He says, put out in the deep. So that was the first thing he commanded. Then he said, let down your nets. Now, in the original King James, I think it says one net instead of nets. The other translations add the S. But here's the thing. He's questioning, but yet he's still obeying. And it says that, and the third thing he commanded him was to have an expectation for a catch. He wasn't just telling him to go through the motions. He said, I want you to expect to have that catch. So launch out, be willing, be obedient, cast your nets, and have an expectation. I'm going to get something out of this. I'm going to get a catch. See, that's why we pray. When we pray, the way we pray is we have an expectation. That's why I pray for the offering the way I do, because I'm expecting God to be good on His Word that says if we'll give from a good heart, if we'll give out of obedience, if we'll trust Him, that He'll provide our needs. See, I want to be obedient. I want to do it, and then I want to have an expectation that God's going to do what He said He's going to do. I don't know about you, but I'm fired up tonight. I like this good preaching. Amen? Now, let's go on, because remember, Peter did have a great haul, and God did bring out, Jesus did receive the big catch. But I want to get to some other things tonight. Look at Matthew chapter 14, and I want to look to, those were things that we needed to, examples of following Jesus' command. But I want to get to some scripture tonight from Matthew chapter 14, and I want to share, and I want to talk to you about some obstacles, four obstacles that keep us from following Jesus' command. You know, there's things that keep us from following His word, His direction for our life, the things that are in our lives that need to be done. And he says, in this is the story of the feeding the 5,000, and the heading above verse 13 in my Bible says, Jesus feeds 5,000. Now, I've taught this before here, I believe, one time, and you know what I added to that? It wasn't just Jesus, it was Jesus and the disciples. Did Jesus need the disciples? No, he could have rained down manna, could have flown in quail, had their feathers all fall off, go by a fire and had them cooked for him if he wanted to. I mean, that's a little added part of it, you know, but we do have illustration in the Old Testament where manna came down, right? Nobody had to cook anything. They just walked out the door, and it was like all these city folks today think, you know, well, where does bread come from? Well, the store. You know, where's meat come from? Well, the store. They don't understand all the, you know, Jesus, that was kind of the way they were in the wilderness. They just walked outside and got their manna. After a while, they started complaining, but I don't know where those people would, well, you know, we would never do that, right? Verse 13, let's read. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. And when Jesus landed and saw the large crowd, he had compassion on them, and he healed the sick. Evening approached, and the disciples came to him and said, this is a remote place, and it's already late. Send the crowds away so that they can go to the village and buy something for themselves to eat, or buy some food. Jesus replied to them, why do they need to go away? You give them something to eat. So Jesus is automatically speaking into their lives, challenging them, and he's giving them an assignment. He says, you give them something to eat. Now, in verse 17, it says, well, we have only five loaves of bread and two fish. Now, the first thing I want to bring out or point out that is an obstacle for us following Jesus is too busy doing you. We get too busy doing us. You ever heard that statement? Now, this is kind of, you know, one of these cool statements. You just do you, right? They just want you to do what feels good, do what's right, do what works for you and all that kind of stuff. And there's an element of that that's right. Like anything that comes from the world, it usually has an element of right. It's just usually a little bit off, a little bit warped from what God might have. But it's okay to in that first thought of doing us. But how many people do them and don't have time for church? And don't have time for Bible study? And don't have time for fellowship? You know, I love the fact that we can do all this online. And I do not preach. I do not hammer on you about church attendance very often. Very seldom does it. So everybody watching online, it's cool. You're good. I love you. But we need you here as well when you can be. When you can, I'm thank God that they're tuning in. That's a phenomenal thing. But at the same, some people are living too far away. We got some from the Philippines, and we got people from, you know, other states and South Dakota and all over, you know, that'll watch. They obviously can't be here, but I hope that they find church where they're at to also be a part. See, we need to be where the action's happening. Thank God for the technology. Thank God that that the church has left the building, that the church isn't just in the building. But there's also a valuable that Bill needs encouraged once in a while. Amen, Bill? I mean, we need one another. We need at times to bring that praise report and all get a smile to know that Donna got through and Larita got through. And we need to be able to stand and praise God that Bill has a birthday and there's an anniversary, and those things are good. But where the action is, sometimes there's a different dynamic whenever you're in the presence of other people that are hungry for God. See, sometimes there's an obstacle that we're so busy doing life that we forget about the value of assembling ourselves together. So just a little caution for us. You know, I wrote this down. David didn't beat Goliath from the wilderness. Now think about that. He learned how to beat Goliath in the wilderness. He trained. He was prepared. He proved himself faithful. God showed up in the wilderness, but God needed him where the action was happening. So don't make sure that we're where God needs to be. Now listen, it's not all happening in the church. All right? So I used that illustration just to, you know, I'm thankful, man. We're back. We're 60%, 70, maybe 70%. You know, that's pretty good on a Tuesday night to still get this many people together. I'm thankful for all of you who give of your time and all of those things. But what about somewhere else you might be needed? Make sure that we're available. We're available for God to use. The other thing is we got to be willing to give what we have. That verse 17. We only have five loaves and of bread and two fish. And I bet you Peter and Andrew were over there saying, yeah, and we're fixing to divide it up and we're going to eat it because we found the little kid that had this running by and y'all just stay away. Now, I mean, I don't know. That might have been part of the story. You never know. But what did Jesus say? In verse 18, he said, bring them here to me. So the thing we've got to do is make sure that we're not so busy doing our thing that we're not giving God what we have. See, some of you have talent. Some of you have time. Some of you have resources of some kind that are important and that are of value. But I tell you what, it is amazing how much goes into running things sometimes. And some of you have the ability to help. And you know, I see a shift and a change in what happens spiritually and how people are impacted, and it's in direct correlation to how much prayer is involved. One of the things I've always said all the time is never initiate more than you can saturate in prayer. But I can tell you that I can't do it all. It takes all of us praying together. And so one huge thing, you know what? Here's the thing. Your dedication to pray for the ministries and pray that God use and accomplish and do great things, it may never be seen by people. But when you stand before God and you have been a part of and a contributor to what God's doing, it's going to be credited to your account. And I believe that full and wholeheartedly. So we got to be willing to give. We also got to understand that no matter the cost, we need to give it all to Him. You know, He doesn't always require it all. But we ought to have a willing heart that says, it's all yours. God, what do you need? You know, that can be sometimes a scary thing. There have been times whenever I've offered things that I loved. A boat, a trailer, a horse, you know, stuff. And you said, God, what do you want? What do you need? What of it is, what of this stuff is of you? And what stuff is that I don't need that you need more? And you know what I've learned is I never lack for what God, what is needed. I remember one time I was, God had, a man came and he ministered at our church when I was about 14 years old, and he brought a guitar. It was a nice guitar. He gave this to me. He prayed over me. He said, I believe God told me to give you this guitar that you're going to use this that you're going to use guitar in part of your ministry. And at that time, I was like, I ain't called a ministry. What are you talking about? I'm going to be a rancher and a cowboy. I might play that on the back of my horse or something. But, you know, I was like, I'm not going into ministry. But he knew what he was talking about. Now, here was the interesting thing. I used that in ministry as a teenager. And then I kind of got to running away from God, and I kind of got to not following God. And for a period of time, I carried that, but I carried that guitar around for years, even after Sue and I were married. We were over in Arkansas, and I wasn't playing. I hadn't played guitar in a long time, and so I had that. And there was a cowboy minister who was used to come over there, and he's passed away now. But I would see him, and God spoke to me one night to give that guitar to him. Well, I took that guitar. And I gave that to this man, and he said, you know, that is amazing. He said, this is just like God. He said, there's a girl that has been praying and came to me, wanted me to pray for her, that she's believing God for a guitar. And she asked me to pray with her, and so I got the exact place for this guitar. And he pulled it out, and he's looking at it. He started playing it, and he played all the time. I mean, and he goes, man, he goes, I think I'm going to keep this guitar, and I'm going to give her mine. And this is a nice guitar. I said, well, thank you, God. But you know what I told God? I said, God, if I ever need a guitar, and if you ever want me to begin to play again, I'm going to trust you. I'm sowing that seed. I'm giving that away. I gave that away. Do you know how many guitars that I've had since then? And I, at 43, about 10 years ago, I started playing again. And I just picked it right up. And you know, I don't know, great, but I play good enough, you know, good enough to when I have to, I can play some songs and we can get by. But you know what? I've enjoyed that. And God's used that because we decided, what do I have? That's just one example of things I've given away. I've given away boots and, I mean, just a lot of stuff. As God, what do we have that we can give? Not just our time, sometimes our resources, sometimes things that we've been blessed with. So, give what you can. So that's the first obstacle, is don't be so busy doing you that you forget to spend time saying, God, what do I have that I can give, that I can sow, that I can offer to you? The other thing, the second thing is this, we got to be careful of the voice of reason. Sometimes the voice of reason will be an obstacle to following the command of God. Why? Because he'll reasonably, we're just being real. You ever hear that? We're just being real. We're just being reasonable. Well, you know what? I wrote this down. Being real can keep you real limited and only reasonably blessed. Do you want to be reasonable and reasonably blessed, or do you want to be abundantly blessed? Do you want everything that God's provided for you? You know, that's not a pursuit of riches. That's not what I'm talking about. But man, I don't want to miss out on any of the benefits, the blessing, the provision that God has for me. I want to not just be real and reasonable. I want to be trusting Him. So that voice of reason, don't let your brilliant mind overpower your yielded heart. The Lord gave me that statement this afternoon. That's a good statement. Y'all ought to write that down. Amen. Don't let your brilliant mind overpower your yielded heart. You know, they could have argued when they could have reasoned in their mind and said, Jesus, we only have 5 loaves and 2 fish, and you want us to feed 5,000. My reasonable mind says, oh, sorry. I guess we're not going to be able to feed them. You see, but miracles come to the ones who are just simple enough to believe and obey. I'm just simple enough to trust God. I'm just simple enough to say, God, what did you say? And I'll follow your command. And you know what? When I miss it, because I have, when I miss it and I realize it, you know, there's something called repentance. God loves that. He is so quick to allow us to repent and to change. Repent and turn. And he's so full of grace and full of love and full of mercy that he'll allow us. It may take some time, but he'll allow us to correct those things as long as we're repentant. Now, we may have missed that opportunity, but more will come. More will come if we'll follow him. So obstacles to following Jesus' command, being too busy, doing our thing, allowing the voice of reason to jump in. Jump over there, in at least on my Bible, in chapter 13, verse 53. It's right there. Jesus is speaking to him. It says in verse 53 of chapter 13 of Matthew, it says, when Jesus had finished these parables, he moved on from there. Coming to his hometown, he began teaching the people in their synagogues, and they were amazed. Man, he's teaching a good word. They are amazed. Where did this man get this wisdom, these miracle powers, they said? And then they began to reason. Isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't his mother's name Mary? That's Mary's boy. Hey, that's old Joe's boy. He's a carpenter down the street. Aren't his brothers James and Joseph, Simon and Judas? Aren't all his sisters with us? Where did this man get all these things? And then they took offense at him. All of a sudden, they began to be reasonable. They began to be real. And they began to think about how can this be? And their brilliant mind got in the way of their yielded heart. They were hungry. They were ready to hear the word. There's times we hear a word or we hear a command or we see God do something that is designed to bless us. And we let our finite mind, I gave you a lot of credit when I said brilliant mind, but we let our finite mind say, but how? But how? How many times have you said that, but yet then prayed and seen God provide? Why don't we fall back to that place? Why don't we get back to that place? Well, we can. We just gotta make sure that we don't allow those things to get in our way. Now I gotta keep. I'm just gonna touch on this one thing. The other thing is no recognition. Don't let the fact that you're not gonna get recognition, and get recognized, and be somebody pay attention to you, to stop you from obeying God. I'm gonna tell you what the things that are done in secret, God said he'll reward you openly. You're not doing it. If you're doing it for the glory or for the recognition, you're missing the boat. You're getting a little small blessing when God has a heaped up blessing. I'm telling you what, that right there, just set your heart, say, God, if nobody ever sees, I'm going to pray. If nobody ever sees, nobody ever says thank you. You ever get a pity party? I used to do that. My wife, you know, I'd get all dressed up nice and slick. She wouldn't even notice. Put on cologne and she wouldn't say a word. Her words of affirmation aren't a gift to her. You know, she doesn't think that much about it, do you? I mean, you do now. Yeah. You're going to tell me, I look good tonight, don't I? See, she. No, I'm just messing with her. But see, if I wanted to, I could have a pity party. She didn't tell me I look nice. So I just tell myself, I look in the mirror, hey, dude, you looking good tonight. See, just learn how to overcome that. Have a little fun with that. See, we got to make sure that we don't let the fact that we're not getting any recognition stop us from following God's command, because God's going to take care of the recognition. I'm going to tell you, someday we're going to stand before God. And you may have sown, you ever sown seed into somebody like, witnessing to them, and then they show up at church and the preacher gets to lead them to salvation. I've done that before. I mean, I've worked on somebody, and I mean, I've sown seed into them, and I've called them and talked to them and posted on their Facebook deal, and I've texted them, and I've done all this stuff, and they go to some other church, and the pastor, and then they make a big deal out of it. It's like, wait a minute, what about all I did? See, we can't be like that. We got to trust God and know that when we go before God, that's all that's really going to matter. The eternal part of it is what we got to pursue on. And I got to wrap this up. But the final thing, and we don't want to miss this, the final obstacle for us following Jesus' command is failure. And I mean, the Lord gave me these in about an hour today. It's pretty cool. Failure. How many times do we allow failure to stop us from following God's command? What kind of failure? Failure at doing it before? Or maybe just failure in our life to measure up to the standard that we think would be good enough to be used by God or to follow that command. We're just not good enough. Well, listen, I got a good addition to I'm not good enough. Join the crowd. Because isn't any of us good enough without Jesus Christ, without His help and without what He's done? I want you to, I'm just going to refer to these scriptures. I'm not going to turn there because I want some more time with Greg. But Matthew 26:69, Jesus is about to leave. He's about to be captured, and he tells him what's going to happen. And Peter says, "I'll never leave you. I'll die for you. I'll never leave you." And what's Jesus tell him? "You're going to die. You're going to deny me three times." Now Peter, I'm gonna do a sermon. I thought about this afternoon of the progression, the transformation of Peter's life. I've always done it over Abraham. I love the progression, the transformation, the changes that took place over the life of Peter. But it says that he wept bitterly when on the third time he denied Jesus after Jesus was going to the cross. The third time he denied Jesus, what happened? The rooster crowed. And he wept bitterly. He'd failed. You ever fail? I mean, sometimes it's public, sometimes people know, and sometimes just you and God know. But man, what an overwhelming thing. And then you think, well, I can't follow God's command because I failed. I wrote this down. Failure is only the end of a wrong act. It's not the end. Failure is not final. Amen. Not where God's concerned. Where God's concerned, if we're repentant, thank God, whatever we face, God can do a work in our life. When we fail, we found a way that something won't work. Oftentimes, that is one of the greatest launch points for us to get in the right direction, as long as we don't allow that to stop us. I also wrote this down. When you make a mess, decide you're also going to make a new beginning. You ever made a mess? You ever blew it? You ever failed? You ever done it wrong? Man, we all have done that. But isn't God's grace good? Isn't it nice to know that regardless of what we've done, that God gives us that opportunity to be restored? And you know, Peter may have denied Jesus, did exactly what he said he wasn't going to do, exactly the way Jesus said he was going to do it. He failed, but that wasn't his final day. He was there when the tomb was empty. And he was there on the day of Pentecost. And he stood up in front of those people. The failure that he had been, and what did he do? Proclaimed the gospel, the good news, and 3,000 people come to Jesus, come to salvation. Impacted the world. And then he was one of the greatest of all of them. The biggest mess, the most emotional, the one that'd stick his foot in his mouth, the one that would get try to correct Jesus. I mean, he's all these other things. But I'm going to tell you what Jesus did in his life after that failure is more important than all the failures. You know, as I close and we go into get ready to go into music, and for those that are watching and those that are right here, the best thing we can do is fall on the grace that's been provided for us by asking Jesus into our life. And if you're a believer and you've allowed any of those obstacles to get in your way of serving God, of following His command, of doing what He's told you to do, it's important that you just make a decision and a choice to say yes to Him. to receive that. You know, if you've never made Jesus Lord of your life, or you're just not sure, there's a way to be sure. It's to say, Jesus, I believe that you're the Christ, that God raised you from the dead. I'm a sinner. I've fallen. I've failed. But I thank you, Lord, that you'll forgive me of my sin. And then I ask you to be my Lord and my Savior. Come into my heart and life and make me a new person. You know, when we make that decision, and you who are watching all over the country, may go completely around the world, but you can make Jesus Christ Lord of your life. And if you're sitting here tonight and you need to pray that prayer, let's pray together. Father, we just come before you tonight and we just thank you that you've given us that awesome way to follow your command. The first command is love the Lord your God. And Lord, we can love you even though we may not feel lovable. But Father God, I thank you and I praise you that even in the midst of all those problems, that Lord Jesus, you knew us. You still died for us. Father, if there's anybody within the sound of my voice that has never made Jesus Christ their personal Lord and Savior, who has never called upon the name of the Lord, doesn't feel good enough maybe, just receive it as a free gift. Say, dear Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Be my Lord and Savior. Come into my heart, into my life. Make me new. Father God, I thank you and I praise you that you'll take that broken vessel, that failure, and Lord, you'll make it new. And I thank you and I praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You know, if you did pray that prayer for the first time, or maybe you just settled it for a final thing, that you've now made Jesus Lord, if you're on media, contact me. If you're here, check us out. And I just challenge you to make contact with me. Let me know. Well, I tell you what, I've been blessed already by Greg. I appreciate the fact that you did more songs early because I went a little bit long. But as Greg comes and ministers, just give him a round of applause. I'm just excited that he's going to minister to us some more. Let's give Greg about.
I love to share some of these old songs that I grew up on. My grandpa was a preacher, and it seemed like as early as I can remember, I've heard songs like, "Farther along we'll know all about it. Farther along we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by."
Amen.
"We'll understand it all by and by."
And then I heard my mama do this song a million times. I believe, yeah.
"Just build my mansion next door to Jesus and tell the angels I'm coming home. It doesn't matter who lives around me, just so my mansion sits near God's throne. Just so my mansion sits near God's throne."
And then my mom just told me a couple days ago, I believe, maybe last week, that this was one of my grandpa's favorite hymns.
"What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What
what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what joy, peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer.
And then one more like that. My dad played guitar and sang, and he loved country music, so we all loved country music, but there was always these country gospel songs in the mix, always. And I heard him sing this a million times, it seems.
He did it all for me. Each drop of blood was shed for you and me. When the Savior cried, he bowed his head and he died. Oh, praise the Lord, he did it all for me. When the Savior cried, he bowed his head and he died. Oh, praise the Lord, he did it all for me. Praise the Lord, he did it all for me.
Oh, I got a half of one more I got to do. I heard my mama sing this a million times.
Come home, come home, it's supper time. The shadows lengthen fast. Come home, come home, it's supper time. We're going home at last.
Amen.
We're going home at last.
Amen. So the enemy played a trick on my mom and dad growing up, and they wound up getting divorced and had six of us kids and seven of us kids, and it was a crazy time. It was hard. And even though my grandpa had prayed and prayed and prayed for us, we stopped going to church, and it broke his heart. But I can tell you, looking back, I can see that God never forgot a single one of my grandpa's prayers. My grandpa never took a single one back, and God never forgot one. Amen. But there I was in Nashville, Tennessee. I'll give you one guess as to why I moved to Nashville, Tennessee. And to make a long story short, I heard this song, and man, it took me back. It was a brand new song that a buddy of mine wrote, but man, it felt like home. And I had to learn it, and I sang it for years and years, and then when I finally got to record it, because of God's math, because we moved in next door to some crazy people who bugged us to death to go to church with them, and we got in the Sunday school class, and in Sunday school class, there's a guy named Marco who just so happens to be the sound guy for the Oak Ridge Boys for like 30 years. And lo and behold, the Oak Ridge Boys agreed to sing with me on this song. Isn't that something? Now, y'all forgive me, I could not get them here to help me with it here tonight. We'll work on that.
Mine eyes, though heavy, will not close. My body begs for rest. When I leave life's table, I still feel consumed by emptiness. Imprisoned in my easy chair, my mouth is parched and dry. In this desperate hour, I see the light from the corner of my tear-filled eye. When there's dust on the Bible, with its pages unturned, it's so simple and yet I soon forget what I've lived, what I've learned. That the word when read, it's water and bread, it's a fount for the lambs of the fold. When there's dust on the Bible, there's a storm raging in my soul. As I read, I feel my misery flee. To my doubts I give the lie. Each word breaks the hold of Satan's hand. I thank God that I realize. When there's dust on the Bible, with its pages unturned, it's so simple and yet I soon forget what I've lived, what I've learned. That the word when read, it's water and bread, it's a fount for the lambs of the fold. When there's dust on the Bible, there's a storm raging in my soul. When there's dust on the Bible, there's a storm raging in my soul.
Amen. So it went something like this. When there's dust, there is dust on the Bible, precious Bible, you know, oom-papa, oom-papa. Do I have time for two more? Okay. I believe I'm supposed to do this. And let me say that I spent time as a prodigal son. Probably still have days. I probably look and smell like a prodigal son more than not. But His grace is sufficient. His grace is sufficient. Do we sin so that grace may abound? Heaven forbid. He wants us to agree with that too. I wouldn't dare try to say anything here to add to what the pastor has said, but it just so happens this is what I'm always telling about, and it just goes right along with what you told about tonight. Probably just a coincidence, right? Not. But it's no small thing that we agree with God. Amen. I know that God chased me all those years that I was the prodigal son. And I never thought of these old country gospel songs that I grew up on as anything real significant in my life. But God wanted to start showing me about how to not take His holy things and treat them as common. And when a song talks about Him, it's a holy thing. When we talk about Him, it's a holy thing. When we agree with Him, it's a holy thing. And what do you know, when I look back, I think about those years as the prodigal son, when I ran from Him, I didn't think that I could live it up. I didn't think I could live well enough to commit to being a Christian. I believed, but I just couldn't live that lifestyle of what I thought it was. And I was absolutely right. Good thing that's not what it takes, amen? So I just wanted to say this, that all those years of being a prodigal son, I look back and I see from time to time God would have me come back and hit home plate by reminding me of one of these old country gospel songs. And if that were all by itself, this song means so much more to me now than I ever knew. I've sang it a couple of million times, it seems. When I was the prodigal son, I'd go to bluegrass festivals and do this song. I just love it. And my kids have learned it and sang it. And now it means so much more to me, and I'll tell you why in a minute. I've been on my way to heaven for a long, long time. So many things has happened, it's clouded up my mind. But I am more determined to walk the narrow way. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. There's a golden street to walk upon, a bell I'm gonna ring. There's a brand new angel in the choir, and I wanna hear her sing. There'll be a lot of friends waiting when I walk through the gate. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. I've walked the lonesome valley, I've climbed the highest hill. I've known the joy of living in the center of God's will. I've seen the angels come and take my loved ones home to stay. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. There's a golden street to walk upon, a bell I'm gonna ring. There's a brand new angel in the choir, and I wanna hear him sing. There'll be a lot of friends waiting when I walk through the gate. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. Amen. So I'd like to share this song with y'all that I wrote last year. A friend of mine named Mary James was talking with me, and she said, Greg, I have a song idea, but I'm afraid to share it with you because it's a tough one. And she shared with me the idea, and then my wife and I got together with her and we wrote the song. Because January 3rd of 2019, we had to say goodbye to our 19-year-old son as he left this world. But as I speak of how this is no small thing, the fact that we agree with God, that day is where the rubber met the road, y'all. Do I agree with God or don't I? Amen. And boy, the clock is ticking. It's time to agree with God like never before. And I thank God that I get to, that I know to agree with Him and His Word about how to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. that eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, nor has even entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for those that love Him. So, this song is a little tough, it's a little uncomfortable, but it's where the rubber meets the road. What really happened that day that we had to say goodbye to our son? It truly is the peace that surpasses all understanding. It's the only peace that there is. When you gave me this son, I thought I was Superman. Turns out I'm not so strong. I don't understand how a dad can be so helpless. Tried so hard to win this fight. Now his mama's holding him, saying goodbye. As you take him to heaven, Lord, I wish that you could wait. I don't think he should be leaving. He's not finished with the race. All I can do is praise you. I know your ways are perfect, but this is more than I can stand. Lord, please let him stay. He's our little Superman. Now standing in your presence, I'll bet he won't believe his eyes at all the peace and wonder. He'll probably ask if he can fly. I can almost see him smiling as you help him understand why he had to run the race he ran. As you take him to heaven, Lord, please help my faith. I can't see the perfect in this plan you put in place. All I can do is praise you that he was ever in our hands. 'Cause I know you'll take good care of our little Superman. Only by the blood of Jesus, he's now healed and in your hands. So thank you, Lord, for letting me take care of Superman. Amen.
Man alive. Was that good? Wow, let's give him another hand. Praise God. You know, I desire to have not just people to put on a show, but ministers here. And I believe tonight we definitely been ministered to. I told somebody else the other day that I thought they was one of my favorites. I think I got new favorites. Don't tell everybody else, you know. But no, I tell you what, I just love men that have a heart for God and are talented. And I said I could play the guitar a little bit. I can't even carry his guitar strap, man. That's phenomenal. I love that. Well, I tell you what, as we close out this night, I just believe God's doing such a great work, and I'm so thankful for you being here. And we just want to stand together in prayer, and let's just close and stand together in prayer. Father, we just thank and praise you that we stand before you and we honor you. And Lord God, we thank and praise you that as we do, that Lord, we can entrust this evening and this word and this fellowship time together into your hands. And Lord, as this service goes out and goes to those that will be ministered to in the future, Lord God, I thank you and I praise you that the anointing and the presence of God will touch their hearts and their lives. And Father, we pray that you continue to bless those that are members and part of this church, this ministry. And I thank you, Father God, that you continue to watch over, protect, and keep us safe. Lord, we thank and praise you that we stand against the wiles and the tactics of the devil, and we receive and walk in the blessing that you provide. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. Well, my treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.